music fills the night. And when you can't contain your joy inside, then dance for Jesus. Dance for Jesus. Dance for Jesus. And live. And with your final heartbeat, kiss the world goodbye. Then go in peace and laugh on glory's side. And fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, and live. Fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus.
I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever. And the sound of his voice is so sweet that the birds hush their singing, and the melody that he gave to me within my heart is ringing. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever. As ever.
wounded sinner, lost and left to die. Oh, raise your head, for love is passing by. Come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come to Jesus and live. Now your burden's lifted and carried far away, and precious blood has washed away the stain. So sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus and live. And like a newborn baby, don't be afraid to crawl. And remember, when you walk, sometimes we fall. So fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus and live. Sometimes the way is lonely and steep and filled with pain. So if your sky is dark and pours the rain, then cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus and live. Oh, and when the love spills over and music fills the night, and when you can't contain your joy inside, then dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus and live. And with your final heartbeat, kiss the world goodbye. Then go in peace and laugh on glory's side. And fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus and live. Fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus and
I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever. Thank you.
speaks, and the sound of his voice is so sweet that the birds hush their singing, and the melody that he gave to me within my heart is ringing. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever as ever known.
Good afternoon, and on behalf of the church at Station Hill and the Heck family, welcome. Thank you for joining this family during this high and holy time, because that's exactly what it is. It's a time to reflect, it's a time to mourn, but most importantly, it's a time to celebrate. And that's exactly the heartbeat of this family, is they want to celebrate the life of Bobby Lee Heck and do so in a way that glorifies God, because that's what we're here to do as well. Pray with me. Father, thank you so much for your love and your grace. We thank you for the life of Bobby, Lord, and what he meant to so many folks in this room today. Lord, we're thankful for the reality that he had a personal relationship with you, and that way, that's the reason that we can celebrate. Lord, we're thankful for the reality that everything that he believed by faith, he now is experiencing by sight. What a blessed hope. What a blessed comfort that is to all of us. And so, Lord, in these next moments, we pray that you will be honored and glorified as we remember our brother. May you be pleased, Father. We love you, Jesus, and we pray it all in your name. And the family of God said, amen.
Good afternoon. My name is Elle Hatcher, and this is my husband, Dan Hatcher. And it is our honor to be here today. We have known this family. We've had the pleasure of knowing this family in a very real way for about 17 years, actually, now. I've seen them in a lot of different experiences, good, bad, and indifferent. And I actually, about a year ago, had the pleasure of doing a business transaction with them and helping assist them with that. And not here to promote my business, so I won't say, but I just tell you that when I walk through that with people, with what I do, sometimes, let's just say, it doesn't bring out the best in people. And so I had the privilege of sitting with Billy and Bobby Heck in the privacy of their home and walking through a transaction with them. And I picked up on a lot of things there in their home, and I saw what you see is what you get. I guess I would just explain her as a gem. That's the way I would describe her. And he was just a gentle giant through the entire thing. I'm telling you, I see some crazy things happen usually in these instances, and it was just a real honor to serve them. I know that Keila and the children, just in general, they are servants. My family and I flooded in 2010. We were very affected that way. And throughout that entire event, they were there for my family, and they were givers. They are rescuers. They are servants by nature. Anybody that I can see, people that know them personally, going, yes, to the nth degree. I've never seen anything like it in my life. The gifts that flow from them, just the God-given gifts and the heart of them, how they serve and how they give and how they love. So today, we just wrap around you, because I'm sure that just like me, many people in this room have been recipients of what you have given and who you are and how y'all love and how you serve. That's what God's called you to do, and you are obedient in that way by nature. It is our honor to be here. The Bible says there's a time and a season for everything. I believe the gentleman already touched on that. And today we do mourn the loss. We do celebrate the life and the love of a husband. I saw him in that room that day in his home just honoring his wife like it was his 20-year-old girlfriend in such a just refreshing way. A man being the godly man and leader of his home and taking his place. And that's the way he treated me like a daughter. And I felt like I was with my dad. And that's honestly, I guess, the highest compliment that I could pay somebody, because I love my daddy. So today we grieve, we celebrate, but we also grieve and we mourn. Anybody who's been, you know, when somebody is this quality of a person, the loss is greater. It's hard, and we've been through it, and it is a process. You grieve not for a day or a week. My mother-in-law, we've been through this, and when we reference the funeral or people we saw, this has been 4 years ago, and to this day she'll say, oh, they were there. I don't even remember that. I don't even remember that. So it is a process, and we wrap around this family, and we love them. And you have been givers, and you've been servants. And so now I know some of you, for your personality, it'll be hard, but you're going to let us love you and serve you. Dan and I are going to sing a song, and it's the prayer, and it is our prayer and our gift for the family today and friends that are here as we celebrate a life well lived. I pray you be our eyes and watch us from above. Stars go out at night in times when we don't know.
Sorry, I'm alone. stasia di speranza ogni
we ask in life because
desiderio te,
and that you watch us from above.
You know, trovi amore.
We hope each soul will find.
Ritorno e dentro se.
Another soul holds you warm.
Let this be. Just like every child.
Just like every child
needs to find a place.
Guide us with your grace.
Give us faith so we.
I'm Patrick Newbill, the son-in-law of this great man for many years, and what a joy. I want to read something to you here called The Ship. I'm standing upon the seashore. A ship at my side spreads her sails to the morning breeze and starts for the blue ocean. She is an object of beauty and strength, and I watch her until at length she hangs like a speck of white cloud just where the sea and sky come down to mingle with each other. Then someone at my side says, "There, she's gone." "Gone where?" "Gone from my sight, that is all. She is as large in mast and hull and spar as she was when she left my side, and just as able to bear her load of living freight to the place of destination. Her diminished size is in me, not in her. And just at the moment when someone at my side says, "There, she's gone," there are other voices ready to take up the glad shout, "Here she comes." And that is the Christian's death. Bob Heck, beloved husband of Billy, father to Kelly, Keela, Casey, Andy, James, Hannah, and Mary. Grandparent, Elisa, Britton, Christy, and Curtis, great-grandparent, Gavin and Quinn, and a brother, a father-in-law, and a friend. First off, because it's of utmost importance, Bob was a man very convinced of in his faith. He believed in one true God, in Jesus Christ, as his son and as the only way to heaven. And because of that conviction, today we're able to be here for a celebration, as well as a time to grieve. And we grieve because we can't imagine a world without Bob, without Dad. And although we know where Bob is at, we still mourn. Scripture says, "Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted." And we know someone who is acquainted with grief, who knows how to comfort. And though he is gone from our side, he leaves a legacy, number one, of his faith. And in just a few moments, you're going to hear how his faith began. It's an exciting, interesting story, what God did there. But his newfound faith, I can tell you, wasn't a one-and-done prayer. it was a life change that not only affected the rest of his life here, but it affected his eternal destination as well. And his faith got him up each Sunday to get those kids to church on Wednesday nights to take that family. He was very much involved in all of that. And even though in those last homebound years he was there and couldn't make it, I still hear about how he watched at least a couple services each Sunday and Wednesdays and all. He would tell me more things about my pastor than I knew. So, yeah, he was good. And by Bob's very existence to this point, God wasn't finished with his faith. God was using Bob in the lives of his wife, his kids, his grandkids, and all of those that he called friends. But Bob also left a legacy as a patriarch, being married some 52 years, having kids and grandkids and great-grandkids. And you know, for those of us who know that history for a little while there, he seemed to have 9 lives because he brushed up with death time and time again. And I think it was the young ones who kept him going. He treasured each of you guys so much. I know how much he loved you. And where Bob led, we followed. Some of you guys know about Knoxville. He got an incredible smoking deal on a house that some of us spent, I think it was 12 years fixing up. I'm not sure. We were there a lot. I remember coming into that house, and there was a giant hole in the kitchen one day. And like a prairie dog, his head just popped right up out of the hole down there. And I remember we fixed that house up for years, getting it all fun. But speaking of there in the kitchen, I heard the other day how the waitress came out of the kitchen even when Kelly and Thomas had just started dating. I think this was maybe the first or second time even getting to hang out with Bob and getting to know Kelly's parents. And something along the lines of, I don't know if it was the waitress or somebody at another table, flipped the ranch dip that went flying across the room onto Thomas. And if you've ever seen Bob laugh, there are times he just can't stop. And apparently he laughed all the way through dinner and just continued to chuckle every time he thought about it. He couldn't contain that laughter. And speaking of that containment, I also heard about how he was in church one Sunday, and he sneezed, and he sneezed, and he sneezed, and each sneeze he thought was the last. And I think Billy wasn't as happy with him. I think I heard something along the lines of about 50 sneezes. And each time he thought, this is it. And she's like, would you leave? And he wouldn't get up. Can you imagine somebody in church, right? Especially now. Sneezing, sneezing, sneezing. Yep, yep, yep. And even a seatbelt couldn't contain the man. As I talked with what I call the three littles here, we talked about one of the funny things with Dad, was he would drive, as they would go down to Cocoa Beach each summer. The seatbelt was too much for him at this point, so he wouldn't wear the seatbelt unless there happened to be a policeman driving by. And then he would grab it and just kind of hold it for a little bit and let it up. But sometimes we don't realize the legacy that we create and leave. And he's passed down some things that those of us in the family and maybe others will remember. Things like a sack full of crystals. He loved crystals. I love crystals. The kids love crystals. And probably each time they go, they're going to think of Papa when they get a crystal and how much he loved them. I didn't get into the potted meat. I don't understand Coke with peanuts in it, but apparently there's a generation that would pop the Coke and there's chunks in there. It's like drinking after my little sister, I remember. But anyhow, and we even say now, as far as do we want to go pay a lot of money for a dinner or eat cheaper? And Casey will say, full is as good as a feast. And that was Papa. And I heard how after church on Sundays, he would tell the kids, hey, we can go out to eat. And he would start driving towards home. And if the family couldn't get along and decide where we're going to go to eat, they're going home. And so they better learn to get along and work together. We carry that on in our family as well. And Christmas, Thanksgiving's always a family, always together. And I remember for me, I had just finished seminary to become a pastor. And Billy said, all right, Bob, it's time to pray for dinner. And I remember him pointing at me and saying, well, he gets paid for it. So, yep, he was funny. He was funny. So he left a legacy of friendships as well. And in this time where we're sad, we remember that family and friends, relatives, they do bring comfort during this time. However, the most comfort we get is in the knowledge of God's sovereignty, that God, he's got the whole world in his hands, truly, and he had Bob all the way up there to the end, and that he gives us a peace that passes all understanding. And I remember talking to Casey about the room that night and how that night, she said it seemed like God's presence was right there. There was a peace in the room. She said it was almost as if he was welcoming Papa home. Bob would not want you to be uninformed about what happened the moment he stepped over. He wasn't alone. Paul said the same thing in Thessalonians. 1 Thessalonians 4:13, but we do not want you to be uninformed, brethren, about those who are asleep, those who have died, so that you will not grieve as do the rest who have no hope. And notice, Paul didn't say, I don't want you to have any sorrow. There's going to be sorrow in this world, but the difference is that we're mourning somebody that we're going to miss for a little while as believers. I think of it like Grandma's house. I remember as a kid, I would go to Grandma's house, and we would have a great time. And when we got in the car to leave, we would cry as kids. But we knew we're going to see Grandma again next trip. But we cried knowing for a while we would be separated. And as believers, we know that for a while we will be separated, but we will be back together one day. 2 Corinthians 5 says, therefore, we are always confident and know that as long as we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. We are confident, I say, and I would prefer to be away from the body and at home with the Lord, so we make it our goal to please him, whether we are at home in the body or away from it. We're either here or there. And on New Year's Eve, Papa stepped across that doorway straight from this body into the presence of God. Straight from here, straight to there. Can Bob see anything going on right now as he's watching this? Well, I know Luke 15:7 says, I tell you in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent. So it would seem that in heaven, we don't know what they can see, but we do know somehow they're aware of something's going on down here. And over one person who chooses to follow Jesus, there's rejoicing in heaven. And Papa is no longer in a scooter. He's hopping up and he's dancing around, enjoying and rejoicing. Amen. And as I said, Bob was firmly convinced in the one true God, one way to heaven, the one Savior. Therefore, according to Ephesians 1:5 says, God decided in advance to adopt us into his own family by bringing us to himself through Jesus Christ. You might not have known Bob was adopted. He was adopted into a divine family. And that divine nature changed Bob. God spoke through him. God used him. We know it. We saw it. I loved how you mentioned the gentle giant, because that's exactly, you could see God living through him. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says that we are a new creation when we accept Jesus into our lives, which means we also have a new eternal destination. And death was simply that doorway that Papa stepped through. And when he stepped through that doorway, he went from here straight into the presence of God. And that is the hope of every Christian. Because I've done funerals where we didn't know if the person was a Christian or not. And with that, it's hard to comfort families. as a Christian, I know he doesn't want to come back here. He can't wait until we get there. But that's the difference. And for Bob, he knew the peace that passes all understanding. And he experienced it that night. And when the moment finally came, it was a lot easier for him than it was for us. I think of it like the story of the man in the garden. And he and his neighbor have been working in the garden. They're out there back behind his house and they're working. It's a day after day. And one day that neighbor finally says, "Hey, you know what? We're a whole lot closer to my house. Why don't you just come on over?" I can imagine the Lord saying to Bob, "Hey, Bob, you've followed me for so long. You're so close to my house. Why don't you come on over?" And Bob said, "Yeah, I think I will." And he stepped right into God's presence. The Bible doesn't say exactly what Bob saw. The Bible doesn't say what he saw when he took that step over. But we've got a hint of what's to come. Revelation tells us that what's to come, the main street of the city, is going to be pure gold, translucent as glass. There is no sign of a temple, for the Lord God, the sovereign strong, and the Lamb are the temple. The city doesn't need sun or moon for light. God's glory is its light, the lamp, the Lamb its lamp. Its gates will never be shut by day, and there won't be any night. Nothing dirty or defiled will get into the city, and no one who defiles or deceives. Only those whose names are written in the Lamb's book of life will get in. And Bob's name was written. Then the angel showed me the water of life river, crystal bright. It flowed from the throne of God and the Lamb right down the middle of the street. The tree of life was planted on each side of the river, producing 12 kinds of fruit, a ripe fruit each month. Never again will anything be cursed. The throne of God and of the Lamb is at the center. His servants will offer God service, worshiping Bob. They'll look on his face, their foreheads mirroring God. Never again will there be any night. No one will need lamplight or sunlight. The shining of God, the Master, is all the light anyone needs, and they will rule with him age after age. It's a neat picture. But there's more. And my most exciting part is there's going to be food. I don't know if there's going to be crystals. And I certainly don't know. Now, Rubel may know about this, but I remember him making me eat one of those bright red hot dogs up in Knoxville from a gas station. And he's at Smoky Mountain or Rocky, I don't know what it was, but it was bright red. That just can't even be natural. Oh. But Scripture says in Matthew 8:11 that there's going to be a feast with Abraham, with Isaac, Jacob, and that we're going to recognize them, which means we're going to recognize Papa, where he's going to recognize us. He's going to recognize all those people who popped up the camper with him years ago, going to the beaches, all those friends that he's met along the way. He's going to recognize all of them. And as we close, God's word reminds us that there's a season for everything. And this is truly a difficult season for our family. Yet in the midst of this difficulty, we can be thankful that God has made a way for not only Bob to spend eternity with him, but also for us to spend eternity with him. When Bob got to those gates on New Year's Eve, if God had said to Bob, "Why should I let you into heaven?" What do you think Bob would have said? But let me throw out an even more important question. What would you say? Because if you think Bob would say, "Well, God, I did a lot of good stuff. Yeah, I did some bad, but I did a lot of good stuff." Casey and I, as we talked through this, there's that illustration of, imagine somebody breaks into your house or your loved one's house and they do terrible things to them. They hurt them horribly. And afterwards, they catch this guy. They're in court. The guy says, "Yep, I did every bit of it. I admit it. I did it all." And as the judge is getting ready to pronounce judgment, all of a sudden the guy says, but wait, judge, hold on. I need to tell you, I served at the food kitchen for the homeless. And I taught Sunday school. And I remember taking meals to people and helping them. What kind of judge? Well, let me ask you first. Would you want that judge to then say, all right, since you've done these good things, we'll let you off? Or would you say, no, a good judge, I realize you've done some good things, but they don't outweigh what you did. There is still a consequence for what you did. Hebrews 9:27 says, it is appointed unto man once to die and then the judgment. Like death and taxes, every person in this room is going to face the judge one day. Every person, it says, it is appointed, and catch that, it is appointed. There is a certain time, and God said, before the foundations of the world, he knew exactly when Bob's date was. And one day, every one of us will have that time pop up, and every person in this room will eventually stand before God. When you stand before him, are you going to try to convince him that you also did good things as well as the things that he says must be punished? Romans 3:23 says, all have sinned and fall short of God's standard. Bob was a good person. We would all say that, a gentle giant. But Bob was a sinner. Thing is, Romans 6:23 says the wages of sin is death. That means what we are due, we're supposed to get eternal separation from God. Not a good thing. But the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. The free gift comes when we believe that Jesus is God's son, that he is the only way to heaven, that he died on the cross to take the punishment that you and I deserved, and that he rose again from the dead 3 days later, and that he's coming again. If you believe that, not just with a head knowledge, because the Bible says even the demons believe and shudder. It has to go from here to here. It's a true belief where you're putting your faith and your trust in Jesus Christ and asking him to forgive you of your sins and come into your life. And that's how he made a way, not only for Bob, but for me and for every person in this room. I know I'm going to see Bob again because I have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. I know where Bob is. I know where my father-in-law is, your friend, your father, your brother, grandparent and great-grandparent, your husband. We're going to see him again. And I have assurance of that hope. So as I finish this, if today you're like, Patrick, I don't know where I would spend eternity. I've never walked through this. I've never asked him to forgive me and come into my life. And today, I want to do that. And this is something, Billy, we talked about. She wants to make sure everybody in this room, that you not only get to see the Lord face to face in a good way, but you also get to see Bob. We'll see if he's eating those hot dogs up there. But if that's you today, I'm just going to have everybody bow your heads, close your eyes. And if you want to pray, it's no magic words. You can say the prayer 1,000 times, but if you don't mean it, it doesn't mean anything. But if you truly want to ask him to forgive you and come into your life, you can say a prayer like this. Or you can say, dear God, I don't think I even understand all of this right now. But I do believe that Jesus is your son. I do believe that he died on the cross to take the punishment for my sin. And I also believe that he is alive today. I know that I am a sinner and that, God, my sin is against you. I ask you to forgive me of my sin and to come into my life. I want to live for you now instead of myself. Thank you for hearing and answering my prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. So I know I've shared some of my interesting stories about Bob today. We wanted to open up the floor and see if any of you guys have a story that you remember about Bob that you would love to share. It can be heartwarming, it can be hilarious, it can be whatever little tidbit that you would like to share. But if you would like to share, you are welcome to stand up. And we actually even have a mic right down here that we can, you can either come to or we can pass it around. But I think the idea is we wanted you to come to it, come to think of it, so you don't have to pass it around. So. I'll just set this right there for you. I'll let you kind of face everybody there.
Here, I'll get away from that guy.
Even better.
I just want to share a brief story, most unique. Probably nobody here has ever met Bob the way I met Bob. I went to the hospital to go visit the family because Bob was going to be in surgery. And I asked the receptionist for the Heck family, Bob Heck family. She writes down some instructions, go down this hallway, turn left, turn right, go past here, go past there. Okay. So I did that. I end up in the pre-op room, and Bob's laying there, and the surgeon is explaining the surgery. And I think one of his daughters, Casey, right there. Yeah, she was there. And so the surgeon just stopped and figured, I was just a deacon. I wasn't a minister or nothing, but I prayed with Bob, and he acknowledged. And I says, you know, we've never met, but I'm going to kind of sit with your wife while you're in surgery. Okay, that's cool. And I prayed with him. It was just so unique to meet Bob that way. And then for the next couple of years, of course, I've interacted with him through my friendship with the other members of the family. So I just thought I wanted to share that unique opportunity that I had of meeting Bob.
Amen.
How to cut an apple into a turkey for a Thanksgiving decoration. How to make my own book. How to back a boat, trailer, camper, or anything else. How to save a penny by doing all the work yourself. And so many more. I couldn't limit that to just three.
three
Kelly, you want to come read to us? This is the longest night that I'll let you take it away.
So as we've shared some stories and memories and some photos over the last few days as a family, we know a story that's been repeated at our family gatherings for years would once again be repeated. Several years ago, we asked Dad to write this account down of that day, and he did. So I'd like to share with you all in his words, and maybe a little editorialization, how a summer evening with five children under the age of 10 unfolded. It was the summer of 1979, and after years of preparation, the Billy Graham Crusade had finally arrived in Nashville, Tennessee, and the services were being held at Vanderbilt Stadium. The crowds were large and responsive. My wife, Billy, and I attended the first two nights of the crusade with our family. She had volunteered to be a counselor at the services, so at the conclusion of the service, she would walk to the front and offer a word of encouragement for everyone that responded to the invitation. So we had three daughters that were 10, 9, and 8 years old at that time. Additionally, we had a foster daughter and a 4-year-old that was 4, and her brother, and that foster son was 3 years old. We lived in a new subdivision near Franklin, Tennessee, about 15 miles south of Nashville. The crusade had designated Wednesday night as the family night to encourage families to get out and attend together. Having attended the first two nights and after a hard day at work, I asked my wife if I could be excused from the evening service. I told her I would keep the kids and take them swimming in the subdivision pool. Also, I needed to go to Franklin and pay our electric bill, as this was the last day to pay the bill and take the on-time discount of a few dollars. And every dollar made a difference. Enough that he would decided to keep 5 children at home by himself to save a few dollars. So my wife reluctantly agreed to my plan. After allowing the children to play and swim, I decided to just load them in the car in their swimming suits and their trunks and their bare feet and take them to Franklin to pay the electric bill and get something to eat. I arrived at the electric company's drive-through drop box. As I got my bill together to pay, my car died. I had run out of gas. I had failed to notice that the gas gauge was on empty. Luckily, the car was on level ground, so I got out and I pushed the car back away so I wouldn't block the pay slot from anyone else, and I searched the car for something that I might be able to transport some gasoline in. In the trunk, I found a dented minnow pail that I used for fishing. I removed the inside of the bucket, and taking the pail, I in my flip-flops and cut-off shorts, along with my 5 barefooted children in swimsuits, 10 years old and younger, began to walk to find fuel. We walked by the city square, behind the courthouse, and we gingerly made our way down the alley behind the stores on Main Street, doing our best to miss the broken grass that lay in our path. I carried the 3-year-old boy and held tightly onto the hand of the 4-year-old sissy. Upon reaching the gas station, I stood the children out of the way. I pumped gas in my pail, and the bucket was a 2-gallon capacity, but I knew that if I tried to get too much, I would slosh it on the way back. So I only filled it about half full, and it was time to retrace our steps to make it back to the car. And I remember this being dark at this point. When the children and I reached the car, I faced the dilemma of getting the gas into the tank. So I searched the trunk of the car and I found a cardboard box like a man's shirt might be wrapped in. I felt this was as good as I was going to do, so I proceeded to form a funnel to pour gas into the tank filler hole. The non-leaded restrictor opening made it more difficult to get the gas in the tank without spillage. However, I got in as much as I could. Finally, with a little gas in the tank, it was time to feed the children. I fired up the car and proceeded to McDonald's, which was only several blocks away. I placed my order at the drive-in speaker and was instructed to pull to the window for my order. After a short time at the food window, I was asked to pull over into the nearby parking spaces as they were out of an item in my order, and they would bring it out to me shortly. As I waited to conserve gas, I turned off the engine. It was not long until my food was brought, so I turned the ignition key to start the engine to head home. The motor did not turn. My battery was dead. I exited the car, raised the hood, and prayed for a good Samaritan to happen by. Shortly, a nice man with jumper cables came to my rescue and got me running again. Since I was only about 3.5 miles from home, I thought I was home free. Well, I wasn't. Driving out down the highway at 45 miles an hour, I was 1 mile from home and I heard a pow. And then a hubcap went running down the road beside me. My front left tire had blown out. I gripped the steering wheel with both hands and I told the children to hold on that I was gonna drive us home on the flat tire. That happened. So I certainly did not plan to change a tire with 5 children in the car, which he could have done and taught us all a lesson, I'm sure. I certainly didn't plan. So with the car vibrating more with each turn of the flat tire, I made the last turn toward home. Much to my surprise, all of a sudden, I am covered up in papers, letters, receipts, and anything else that had accumulated over the driver's sun visor, which he thought was a storage space for everything that had arrived in the last 6 months. It came crashing down. It just went everywhere. He still didn't lose his temper. I can't imagine on the inside what he had to be saying, but he didn't lose his temper. And so now there's papers everywhere. All the shaking had broken that. And so not to be deterred, he said, I brushed aside the papers, and he said, I'm taking us to the house. Once again, he was in error. Just after stating, I'm going to the house, the motor stuttered and died. He was out of gas. I coasted to the side of the road, opened the back door for the kids to get out, and said, come on, kids, we're going home. And we walked home. And I guess the moral of this story is family night at Billy Graham is not to be missed. So we've passed this story around for years. I mean, we were, again, 9, 8, 7. It comes up, and if somebody new comes into our family, they get to hear it. And we all, you know, talk about all of our different accounts and what we think and how we remember it and all that. So years ago, we said, just please write it down for us. So he did write it down for us with the intention, this is to send it to Billy Graham and whatever and let him know what an impact they had had on our lives. But that was an evening that none of us will ever forget with our daddy. And as amazing as it was, he never lost his cool. He took all 5 of us. He got us where we had to go, and he got us home safely. And he fed us McDonald's, which was actually a pretty big event for us.
I'm Diane McCall, and this wonderful gentleman is Ben Hall. I know this wonderful family, Billy, and the kids, because I'm a nanny to those 2 little darlings down there. And this is what Billy asked me to sing, and it's a joy to get to do this for you. Thunder.
my power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art! How great thou art! Then sings my soul. Shall come with shouts of acclamation, and he will, to take us home. Oh, what joy will fill my heart. Then I shall
that everybody join in, because it is our story. Oh, blessed restorance, Jesus is mine. Come on, you can do better than that. Savior, all the day long.
What a powerful testimony of a life well lived. Thank you so much for sharing the stories. And I didn't get the privilege of getting to know him, but I feel like I know him a lot better. And I look forward to a day getting to spend eternity with our brother. Amen. What a powerful testimony. And it's one of the things you glean from something like this. For those of us that are in Christ, and this is the hope that we have through Jesus, that it's not goodbye. It's see you later. Let's pray together. Father, thank you so much for this powerful testimony as we have reflected on just a few of the moments, but Lord, what profound moments they are, Lord, as we have celebrated the life of our brother. And so, Father, right now I pray in the name of Jesus that you will go with this family, go with his friends, Lord, all those that loved him dearly, that need a comfort that can only come from you. Lord, I pray you walk with them in the days, weeks, months, and years ahead. Lord, and may they continue to celebrate and reflect on all the good that you have done through our brother Bobby. Lord, and most of all, help people come to know you as a testimony of his life and the legacy that he has left with his family, Lord, in you. Lord, we do love you. We pray you let the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight because you are our rock and our redeemer. We love you, Jesus, and we give you all the honor and glory, for it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Maybe it's missing.
I come to the garden alone while the dew still on the road.